Hi, I'm Larry Dapsis. I'm the entomologist with Cape Cod Cooperative Extension. And in this segment, we're going to be talking about the functioning of the tick-borne disease ecosystem. And it's a very interesting set of processes that are going on before our eyes, and we may not even realize it. Ecology happens to be my favorite discipline in science. And one of the reasons for this is that we find out that everything is interconnected. You can't have an impact on one thing over here and not have an impact on something else over there that you didn't even know about or even anticipate. And so we're going to start telling our story of mice and men and women, ticks, and acorns. One of the questions I get all the time from people, particularly baby boomers. Larry, 40 or 50 years ago, we just didn't have to worry about these things at all. What is different today? What's changed? They don't realize what's happened over time. And a lot of things have changed over time. So it's a very good question to ask, though. So where are we? If we look at Lyme disease incidence by state, all six New England states occupy the top six positions in the country. So we truly are living at ground zero. So it's a fair question to ask, how did we get into this pickle? Well, a lot of people for many years, including today, want to blame the deer, okay? It's all about the deer. And certainly deer can feed a lot of ticks. You see here on that deer's ear, there's lots of fully engorged female deer ticks. And each one of those ticks can lay 1,000 to 3,000 eggs. So why aren't we just overrun with ticks? We certainly have a lot of ticks out there, but not certainly to the extent that these numbers would suggest. There's other things going on. So is it all about the deer? Well, Rick Ostfeld at the Cary Institute of Ecosystem Studies in New York studied this for a number of years. They looked at deer density in the fall when larval stage ticks would be actively feeding, and then they looked at the density of nymph stage ticks 2 years later. So there's a time lag in there, and we'll explain that in a few minutes. And so if the density of deer truly were correlated with the density of ticks, we would see these data points line up in a straight line from the lower left to the upper right, but we do not. It looks like a random assortment of data points. And so if you calculate the relatedness of these things, that statistic, R squared, that's a correlation coefficient. The correlation coefficient is essentially zero. There is no correlation between the density of deer and the number of ticks you're going to see 2 years later. In our own research here, we did surveillance on Cape Cod and Nantucket for 6 years. And we look at the deer density on Cape Cod relative to Nantucket. Here on Cape Cod, we have about 10 deer per square mile, not a whole lot. Out on Nantucket, yeah, they've got 50 per square mile. Those things are everywhere. Does Nantucket have five times more ticks than we hear on Cape Cod? Well, we sample tick populations so we can compare apples to apples. And what we do is we drag a piece of white flannel through vegetation. So we'll do a drag for 30 seconds, count the number of ticks, do it again for 30 seconds, count the number of ticks. And you come up with this metric of deer tick nymphs per hour. So you can measure relative density. And so if you look at Cape Cod versus Nantucket, we have about the same number of ticks. So it's not about the deer. There are other things involved here. So what we know is that if you look from the bottom up, so to speak, acorns, mice, and ticks are all linked. And I can see you scratching your heads now. Larry, explain this one to me. So here we go. Understand that acorns, that is the fuel that drives this whole ecosystem, okay? It all starts really with the acorn. And the way this works is, in the fall, if you have a large number of acorns that have fallen, that next year you're gonna see an increase in the mice population, and yeah, the mice are very happy when those situations happen. And the next year, you're gonna see an increase in the tick population. And again, that's good news for the ticks. But let's say we have a year where there's low to no acorn production, okay? So let's say in the fall we have, you know, a lack of acorns, and during that late summer there were plenty of mice to support those larval ticks, And those larval ticks that fed on the mice, they're going to become nymph stage ticks and hunker down for the winter. So then we have this crash of no acorns in the fall. And what that does is it leads to a crash of the mouse population. So yeah, sad news all around. So in the spring, those nymph stage ticks emerge. And so now people and pets are going to have a higher exposure risk. So here's the best way to think about this, is that ticks are like little landmines. You bump into one, something bad might just happen. And think about the mice, they're little minesweepers. So if they're out doing their daily mouse thing, they're picking up ticks, and each tick that attaches to a mouse is one less tick that you might be exposed to. So without the minesweepers, it increases our exposure risk. So when I was digging into this area of the ecosystem, I came across records that in 2004 in Massachusetts, we had a statewide acorn crop failure. And this is pretty interesting. So this allows us to test this idea about the minesweepers. And so when I looked at the data for Lyme disease the following year, there was a 51% increase in the incidence rate of Lyme disease in Massachusetts. So this minesweeper idea has a lot of merit. What else has been going on? Well, over the years, we've been cutting down a lot of trees here on Cape Cod. And it's not just the acreage of trees that we have cut down, is that we've cut these forests into patches or islands, a process what we call forest fragmentation. And fragmented forest has a lot of consequences. So if we look at this land use pattern change, this is the area of Falmouth back in 1950, and sure, there was lots of woods, there's a number of farms here, and a number of homes around this pond. And if we look at this place almost 60 years later, that is a suburban neighborhood. So we've, these collections of homes, and we've got these small patches of woods all around the residence. And that has consequences. And one of the consequences is that you reduce biological diversity. And it's not just reducing the numbers of types of creatures, but the kinds of creatures. And so with things like red fox, at a certain point, you don't have enough woods to allow them to have a territory. And the significance of fox is that they are the most efficient predator on these things like white-footed mice that are excellent reservoir hosts for this Lyme disease bacteria. So it leaves mice out there to live longer periods of time and allows them to infect more and more ticks, not just the mice, but also the eastern chipmunk, which is a second runner-up to the reservoir situation. So without the fox, we've given the landscape to the rodents and let them roam freely. The other thing that the poor fox are dealing with is that as coyotes move into an area, they will outright kill foxes or drive them out. So without the fox, we've got an upended situation here. And things like possums. So you're looking at this saying, why the heck would I care about a possum? Well, here's why we should care about our poor possums disappearing, because they are the equivalent in the tick world of Rambo. Yeah, they kill a lot of ticks. And so animals will allow a certain number of ticks to attach to them before they start doing something about it. So even mice and birds and things like that. And possums happen to be very intolerant. They do not really permit any ticks to feed on them. So they're excellent groomers. And they don't just dislodge the ticks, they actually eat the ticks. And so if you look at the data that the Cary Institute has been working on, when they look at possums, an individual possum is responsible for over 5,000 tick deaths per week. So if there was anything we can do in our landscape to encourage the reintroduction or increase the possum population, we really ought to consider doing that. And we have to look at climate. So one of the things we know is that when we have sunny, dry, warm springs, ticks that might be up on top of vegetation questing, waiting for dinner to somehow stroll by so they can attach. When you get situations where you get, you know, drought and, you know, so dry leaf litter, those questing ticks quickly move down deeper into the leaf litter. Ticks can't drink water. They have to get into an environment where they can absorb water vapor from the air. And so basically that means that during very dry weather during the spring, they're out for fewer periods of time, out for less time. So it reduces our exposure risk. Whereas we have, you know, wet springs, that allows ticks to be up on top of this vegetation questing and looking for meals, so it increases our exposure risk. So weather certainly coupled with the acorn story makes a big difference here. So here's my contact information. Always open for business. Look forward to your phone calls and exchanging emails. And we'd like to thank Cape Cod Healthcare for their generous support of this program.